And we're live. Welcome to another episode of Something Digital Office Hours. I'm your host, Brian Lang. And today I'm joined by Philip Jackson, Max Chadwick, and Todd Christensen. I will introduce them yet again. Philip Jackson, you should know his face. If you don't know him, you're probably new to the Magento community. And you at least know his hair. Philip is a long-time Magento luminary and two-time Magento master. We'll see what happens this coming year. Max Chadwick is the lead of our Something Digital Strategic Engagement Group. He is also quite the voice in the Magento community and has contributed to Magento Core in many ways and has spoken at different conferences such as Meet Magento New York and Mage Titans. And we also have Todd Christensen, who is also a core contributor to Magento and is actively consulting with Magento on how to improve different things. So thanks to everyone for being on for another episode. Before we get started with your questions, and please do submit questions live on Facebook. And you can, you already found us if you're listening to me, but if you watch this afterwards, facebook.com/somethingdigital, that's digital without the vowel and between the T and the L. So I hope to see you on the next one if you're watching afterwards. So before we get going, I just wanted to call out something. We recently released our ebook on accessibility, and that was written by our very own Philip Jackson. Philip, do you want to say a few words about the book before we?
Yeah, sure. We have an ebook that's available. Part two is coming pretty soon, but it is a tour of why you as a merchant or why you as a digital agency or as a developer may want to start implementing web accessibility into your e-commerce projects. And there's a lot to it. There's a lot of reasons why. And so we get deep into that and we tell you how to do it. And we tell you the reason, the who, what, why, where, when, and how, all those good stuff. So go check it out. You find it at somethingdigital.com. I believe it's on the SDN Sites blog, the announcement. You want to get it over there. So.
Great. Thanks, Philip. Yep. We also have a couple events coming up that you should be aware of. If you're in Seattle, we're going to be at the Filson flagship store on February 8th at 6:30 p.m. We'll be doing a merchant-to-merchant event there. That's a live podcast event hosted by Philip Jackson. And we'll be talking about seasonality in business, how to combat seasonality and harness it really to be successful if you're in a very in a very seasonal business, or if you're not in a seasonal business, maybe some ideas of how to use seasonality to your advantage. So really looking forward to that. Couple of people will be on the panel. Del Monson from Filson will be on that panel. And also Trevor Phillips from Mervin Manufacturing will be on that panel. It's also going to feature some local food and cold brew, and it's just going to be a really fun event. The Filson flagship store is amazing if you haven't been there, so I highly recommend getting out to it. Also, we'll be at Etail West coming up here in Palm Springs at the end of February. I will be attending that along with our president, Greg Steinberg, and so definitely meet up with us there if you're attending, and we'd love to see you. With that, let's get into the questions. So here's our first question of the day. I know Elasticsearch comes native in Magento. Do you use it for your clients? Can you tell me more about what it can do? How do I set it up? Do you have alternatives that you recommend? Max, why don't I start with you on this?
Okay. That's a loaded question or a many part question. So I'm going to go one by one. So I know Elasticsearch comes native in Magento. Do you use it for your clients? Yes, we do. Elasticsearch comes native in Magento 2, the enterprise version. And that is what we use very often with our clients. It's very superior to the MySQL full text search engine, which would be the alternative if you were using the open source version of Magento. So can you tell me more about what it can do? So it's Elasticsearch is a search engine. And so it indexes data and you can run queries against it and look up documents is what Elasticsearch calls them based on the terms. And MySQL is not really designed to do that very well. MySQL is a database, a relational database for storing relational data like orders and customers and products and things like that. So it's a much better search engine to use with Magento. How do I set it up? So there are guides from Magento that have all the documentation you need to. It's not that complicated. You need to install Elasticsearch basically, and then through the Magento admin panel, you just need to tell it where the Elasticsearch server is running. And do you have alternatives? So the Elasticsearch is built into Magento, and it's way better than what you would get with MySQL. But there are definitely some more sophisticated things that you can do that you would add on top of Magento. So there are many tools. I personally don't have a specific preference that I would recommend, but there are a lot of tools I know that you run your search through some third-party service, and they can help with, like personalization or improving the autocomplete, which is not so great in the default Magento implementation, and a lot of other things. So going through all the questions, I think that is my answer on everything.
Well, Philip or Todd, do you want to add to this?
I'll give the contrary point of view, and then I'll let Todd kind of follow up and split the difference between Max and I.
Sounds good.
My take is that while Elasticsearch is wonderful and it's great to have it out of the box, a lot of times the things that Magento's search does by default are not the things that a retailer wants. So a good example of that would be the predictive search in Magento doesn't work the way that you would intuit that it works.
There is no predictive search in Magento.
Exactly.
The autocomplete. Yeah, I brought up the autocomplete.
Right. So the autocomplete and the type ahead search.
I have a really funny story about the autocomplete, but
yeah. So I want you to get into that because it's interesting. Okay. For a brand new site that's launching, your expectation would be that when you're typing in the search box on the front end of Magento, when you're trying to search the catalog, that it would return relevant results based on keywords that you're searching for. So if you are typing the name of a product, it might autocomplete the name of that product or a category, but that's not how it works. What it's actually autocompleting is prior searches that return positive results. So if you could think about how that could possibly work out poorly for you, you might come up with some scenarios in your mind of how that might not be okay. The reason that's all interconnected into how Elasticsearch is set up in Magento is that Magento's default search uses it in a very specific way. My suggestion generally is that a third-party search service will give you a lot more bang for your buck than investing in the Elasticsearch implementation. The reasoning is that a third-party service that only ever does anything but focus on search will have things like relevant dashboards to show you how often your keywords are showing up in conversions. And it'll show you dashboards for how often you're getting search query misses. So maybe you need to rewrite some product content. It's going to be a more fully featured product that gives a retailer the kinds of insights into the data that you're going to need from searches and allow them to do a little bit more with it. It also, in my opinion, it's going to provide the user experience. So a product like Klaviyo, for instance, it's going to provide the kind of user experience with graphical like images in the dropdown in the type ahead search. It's going to give you, you could even merchandise that section and have filters that slice and dice the search results. And in my experience, that it gets you a little closer to what most people are actually looking for out of search, instead of them investing in the inbuilt search and having to be an expert. Now, I've written a blog post, I believe, on why you would not use a third-party search, and there's a lot of reasons why you might not do that. We could get into that, but that's not, I think it's outside the bounds of this question. So, sorry, both of you wanted to chime back in on this, and I think that's just the two cents I had.
I'll go first, and then we'll circle back to Max. So,
yeah.
So I do want to split the difference. I will say that, you know, I totally agree with that perspective in general. And I think it circles back to, you know, an email service provider or questions like that. You know, with Magento, you can send emails. You could implement something like a marketing blast. You could have all your transaction emails go through your hosting provider. Is that the best option? Well, ask yourself if you want someone, you know, who is dedicated to your email and has someone sitting there just making sure emails are going out, or if you'd want it to go through your hosting provider or Magento, where there's a lot more, you know, problems where that's what it's dealing with, right? So, you know, if you host on Magento Commerce, right, which is the cloud, you by default get SendGrid, which is that separate service that's sending your emails, right? And that's the same kind of type of concept where for a lot of these things, you want something dedicated to that. But I will actually say, I think you can still get benefit even when you're using a third-party search provider in enabling Elasticsearch on your store, because Elasticsearch is used by Magento to power the catalog and other filtering. And some of that may not come from the external search provider. So that right. There may be benefit to having both.
Sure.
Max, you want to close it up?
Oh, yeah. So I had an anecdote. So we were talking about the search autocomplete, and I've also dug into that quite a bit. I wrote a module for Magento 1 that didn't, you know, change it entirely, but added some additional enhancements on it. One of the main issues with the way that it's implemented is that it shows you the search terms and it doesn't limit them. So you can get into these, you can have these experiences where you start to type something and you have like literally 50 or 100 search terms running down the page, and it's not a very good experience. And I built a module that lets you limit it, and it had some other things. And then I actually went to port that into Magento 2. And I wound up submitting a pull request to Magento 2 to have them bring it in. It's actually still open, but you know, we were the reason it's funny is because we were talking about how most people, you know, it doesn't work like the autocomplete doesn't work like most people expect it to. And when I submitted the pull request, Magento, the community engineering team had turned it over to their QA, and then their QA had like reported, "Oh, this isn't working as I expect." And it was like, well, that's not my code. That's just how it works. Their QA didn't actually understand how it was supposed to work. It was kind of funny.
Yeah. Something digital, if you need help with your QA, if you need help in your Magento community engineering QA, just give us a call. We're glad to help over here at SD. That's funny.
Great. Well, thanks for the answers, guys. That was great. Here's another question. Do you recommend using a theme for Magento? Do you have any that you would recommend? I'll send this to Philip.
ooh, me. Yes. In general, you should always use a theme with any website that you set up ever. That is a great thing that you should have. Magento has a sort of a storied and sorted history with its themes, its inbuilt themes. The themes that ship with Magento, actually, you know what? Come, let me take you on a journey. I'm going to give you a history lesson. So Magento originally back in the day was following sort of the WordPress model in that back in like 2008 to 2011, it actually shipped with multiple themes. Okay. So Magento had a theme that was called Blank that it shipped with. It had a theme that was called Blue, I believe, that it shipped with. And then another theme called Modern, I believe, All of those were really created to not to really be themes that you would ever want to actually use, but more to demonstrate a functionality that Magento has built in, which is a theme inheritance, or a theme, well, it's not really inheritance, more like fallback back in that day. And then Magento revved all of that with their responsive update back in the Enterprise 114 days. And so when that came around, we actually got names for the themes that were sort of branded and you could recognize. And that one that shipped with Magento 1 was called Madison Island. So we now have this sort of history. Madison Island also did sort of the same thing. It's not a theme that you really should use or architect on top of. It did introduce something called, you know, theme inheritance, where I could create a child theme of the Madison Island theme, but it does a lot of things that are extremely opinionated that sort of lock you into aggressively overriding the way that it implemented things, for instance, in CSS and in JavaScript. And sort of those interactions. So what Something Digital has done for the last 3 or 4 years is we actually create a theme that is based off of the blank theme. It's created based off of the most unopinionated theme. It's only the bare bones of what you need. And so, yes, you should use a theme. I think the question hints at something, which is, should we be using a commercial theme? Does that mean we should go out and go to Theme Forest and buy a commercial theme and use that on Magento? And the short answer is no. And the reason being is that most of the themes that are developed, even when they say that they're compatible with Enterprise, are absolutely explicitly not compatible with Magento Enterprise. Magento Enterprise has a lot of things and features and functionality that are out of the box that what we, in our experience of 10 years of Magento development, not a single theme has ever done extremely well or in a very robust way. Even very popular themes get this wrong. So what winds up happening is the time that you would typically spend, you know, that you're trying to save by purchasing a commercial theme so you can focus on other things in your project is actually spent bug fixing that theme for the developer. And usually this presents itself later on in a project when we're actually doing things like production testing and we're starting to see errors with full page cache. We're starting to see incompatibilities with you know, other modules, like for instance, gift registry, or there are always little misses with the Enterprise version of Magento because most theme developers are developing for the open source product. And because it's arguably, it's the largest install base in the Magento community. There's, you know, probably 250,000 Magento open source sites in the wild. And that's likely what your theme developer, even though they may say very, you know, very explicitly that it's compatible with Enterprise, most are not. Okay, so that all being said, SD, we take a different approach. We've created our own theme called Bryant Park, which it's sort of inherited from an open source project that was created and sort of community driven by the team at Snowdog, which is a Magento agency. In Poland, and they created a front-end theme architecture that inherits from the blank theme, and we feel like it's the best of both worlds. You get the theme inheritance, you get a quick start, but at the same time, it leaves it open for us to introduce things like Bluefoot, Magento's Bluefoot page builder compatibility. We can have we can drive down the size of the CSS that's delivered by only delivering the components of CSS that are required. We can do the same with JavaScript. And then we can actually do a lot of modern front-end build tooling to make theme development a lot faster. And so we have other technologies. For those that aren't technologists, I'm not going to get into all the technologies, but we do a lot of things with theme development that makes it a lot faster for us to get your project up and off, you know, up and running off the ground. And to be honest with you, if you look at the Luma theme, which is the Magento 2 default theme or the demo theme, if you look at the demo theme, Luma has a little bit of age on it. You'll see that there are things that aren't there, like full bleed graphics that go edge to edge, which is what everybody wants nowadays, right? You'll see that there's even Bluefoot has theme components that are for like sliders or carousel rotators, and those are sort of de passé now in 2018. So and inaccessible. We have a whole blog series about why you shouldn't use them, but So we take it a step further and put all that work into it so that you don't have to. And that's all I'll say about that. I'll hand it out to anyone else that wants to pitch in.
Good answers. Todd or Max, you want to add?
Yeah, I mean, the only thing I would say is, it depends, I guess, on where you're coming from. Like, if you're a smaller merchant and you just want to get yourself up and running quickly, and you think Magento is right for you, I mean, you could try picking a theme off the shelf and going with it and see how it works for you. I do think that when you start to head in that direction, like, I've seen projects come to us and it's not just themes, but they get into this direction where they just everything that they're looking for a solution for, they just look for something prepackaged, and they come to us and they have, you know, 50 different modules installed on their site, and nothing has been custom developed, and you start to run into a lot of conflicts and incompatibilities and things when you start to go in that direction. But I mean, if you're just getting started out, it could be a good option, but once you start to grow, yeah, you'll probably want to go more in the direction that Philip's talking about.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. And I just want to say, I mean, I think, you know, a lot of the problems that you'll see with custom themes sometimes, not your own theme, but with commercial theme, you know, are problems that might not be so noticeable at first, right? So, you know, and to Philip's point, you don't see them until later on in the development. So if you're, I would say that, you know, it's not just if you're new, but if you're not picky, right? Which I would think if it were me, honestly, I'm quite picky. I would be picky about, you know, my storefront, right? But if you're not very picky about how you want it to work and how you want it to function, and you're okay with, you know, I paid for, you know, Magento Commerce, I have all these features, but they don't work in my themes, I'm not going to use them. If you're okay with things like that, that's where I would say, you know what, just go with a commercial theme for now, get off the ground, and then once you're ready to use those features, then you can turn around and work on a more full-fledged theme.
One more.
Wait, let me comment on Todd for real quick. I would almost argue that in this case, like in the case that Max and Todd are talking about, I would almost say just use Luma, because, you know, Magento is going to support Luma, and that's better choice than a lot of the other, like, and if you're picking a theme, and it's probably because you don't have a developer or an advanced developer that can help you do this, which means that you're not going to be able to discern what's a good theme and not a good theme. And in which case, I would just use Luma.
Okay. So here's the caveat for all of this, is that if you don't use Luma, if you don't use the base theme that comes with Magento 2, no matter what you do, every third-party module that you install is going to need themed in some way. Because most third-party themes don't only adhere to the classes and the styles that Luma ships with, right? So if you install anything from a Headworks, anything from, you know, Amnesty, if you write your own modules, all of those little things are going to have small graphical differences in the way that the module appears on the front end. It's going to require you to have to do some custom work anyway. And so, yeah, your advice, Brian, is actually really astute in that unless you're using Luma default, which means it's got to look the exact way that it looks right now, like sort of out of the box with new images and maybe fonts and some colors. You're probably going through a theme exercise as it is.
Mm-hmm. Right? That's right. In short, don't use a theme. Like, get someone to do it right. Don't use a commercial theme. Don't use a commercial theme.
Yep. If you are a DIYer, there's always a use case. I don't want to say don't, just flat out don't, but there are caveats there. And if you're a DIYer, you're going to want a page builder tool. And the only way that you're going to get the page builder, the Magento page builder, is to be on Enterprise. And I really hope that you're not rolling your own if you're on Magento Enterprise. I hope that you're using a trusted partner. Okay, anyway.
Great. Any other comments, Todd and Max? Nope. No. Okay, cool. All right. Question number three today is, what's the best way to implement infinite scroll? I'll send this one over to Todd.
I have some opinions here. I'm just going to start out saying that I'm not a big fan of infinite scroll for shopping pages. And I mean that as a user, as a customer. I've gone to sites that have infinite scroll, and I'm, like I said before, I'm a picky, I would be picky about my storefront. I'm also picky about the items that I purchase, right? And so, for example, and this is, a very specific picky example, but I'm particular about the type of keyboard that I use, right? And recently I was in the market to buy a new keyboard. Right. And I was looking online because I wasn't having a lot of luck in local, retailers near me. I was scanning through a lot of products. Unfortunately, all of the sites I could find didn't really let me filter by the filters that I wanted, which, is its own problem. But I mean, you could have 1,000 different filters for keyboards. So, that might be its own issue. But I was just scanning through the products, and one of the sites I came upon did have an infinite scroll, and I got tired of it very quickly because I had no idea when the end was, right? So I'd filtered it down to some subset of the products, but I was still looking through them to find the right one. And because I didn't know how many pages of results there were, after I went through the first small chunk of products, I just felt like, well, it's not going to be here. I went to another site, it had paging, and it had a bunch of pages, it had 10 pages. I went through more of the total products on that site before feeling like this, it's not going to be here, and I actually found one there. So that's one thing to think about. Now, you may have, a lot of people do have better luck with infinite scroll. I've heard good and bad stories. So I wanna start off just saying, if you do infinite scroll, definitely A/B test that and see how it works for your product and your customers, right? Because a lot of people are excited about infinite scroll. It looks cool, especially from a developer or a techie perspective. It seems like a nice thing, but it may or may not be the best UX for your problem. And there's several reasons for this. One, it can be what I just described, but it can also be that, infinite scroll is very hard to get right. And some of the things that you just can't have are like scrolling to the footer, right? So I know people who are just used to being able to scroll to the footer of a website and find certain links like contact us or, live chat or things like that. If you don't have a sticky footer or sticky live chat or you have things in your footer like that, and you might have customers who don't really know how to get to that. I have literally watched someone scrolling on an infinite scroll page, an older person, but scrolling on an infinite scroll page saying, I can't get to the footer,
right?
And frustrated, right? So now that may not be a problem with your audience, right? Especially if you have a younger audience, that may be something they're used to. They'll click onto another page to get to the footer, or maybe they'll just not contact you and not want to. But that's these are some of the trade-offs you have to think about. Another thing to think about is also that techie people often honestly are afraid of the back button. Because, especially if you're a little older and you've used the internet for a while, you've been onslaught by websites telling you do not click the back button. We are not, we will not be held responsible for how many million things happen to your computer or your order or whatever if you ever even look at that back button. But nowadays, people who access sites these days, especially younger generation and the older generation, who haven't been exposed to a lot of that, they use the back button. And so they'll go to a category page, they'll click into a PDP from halfway down the category page, and they'll say, no, not this one, hit back. They won't open a new tab, they'll hit back. And they'll look at the next product. The problem is a lot of infinite scroll implementations everyone I've seen so far from Magento will not handle that correctly. You won't see the product. You'll jump around in your browser. You know, maybe it tries, but you end up in the wrong place, and it ends up being a very weird experience for customers. So those are the things I want to mention.
That you are spot on there. I think this kind of goes a lot with the search question, the first question here, which is it doesn't behave the way that you would expect, right? So this kind of a story time, the very first time at Something Digital that we implemented a infinite scroll on a website or a Magento website for a customer was when I first turned up around here. So a little over 5 years ago. And we found a module from a company called GoMage. I don't know if they exist anymore. We installed it to give it a go. And the very first look that the customer took at the site, they said, this isn't going to work. We said, look, it works just fine. Look, it scrolls, you get to the bottom, it loads the next page. They're like, well, when I click into the product and then I click back, as Todd said, it doesn't take me back to the same page of results that I had before. That's the first problem. The second problem is that what we used to do was we would take the third page of results and we'd send that out in an email to our customers. So our merchandising team would create emails that went straight to paginated results. So we need it to have a shareable link to just the third page of those results. And I think right there, you have two use cases that completely negate the ability to use, well, not just a third party module, but probably infinite scroll in general. And Todd made a great point too, which is there are certain groups of people who want to use your site differently. This is why most of us provide most sites have both a list view for the category and a grid view for the category, right? So we want customers to be able to look at it in the way that works for them, right? They want to digest the content in the way that it works for them. And I think giving them more choices to be able to control that is either a dropdown with number of results or controls for them to be able to toggle those things on and off is the better of the choices. So if you were to do it, giving customers the ability to opt out of the infinite scroll might solve some of these problems. But it's one of those things that sort of rot with all kinds of issues.
Yeah. Speaking of rot with issues, I just wanted to mention one more. Accessibility. I don't know that I've seen an accessible infinite scroll. Because you have to keep in mind, a person who's using a screen reader is not scrolling necessarily. And so, sometimes the screen reader will scroll, but not in the same way as a user. And I've seen a lot of issues with that type of thing. So you see infinite scroll a lot on sites like galleries with images, Pinterest, things like that, that honestly, you don't have a lot of content to read, and you don't have a lot of, honestly, someone who can't see, isn't sighted, isn't going to have a lot to gain out of that website. So there's less to lose. Now that's not a great argument for making that site inaccessible, especially because people can be partially disabled. But that's part of why you don't see it a lot on other sites. There's a reason why Amazon, for example, still uses paging.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, So to me, infinite scroll. What type of a site does infinite scroll make sense on? To me, it's basically a site that you never want anybody to leave. So like Twitter, for example, like you just scroll forever, right? And their goal is they just want you to keep going through the feed. As they don't want you to ever stop doing it. So the same thing with something like Facebook. And when you think about the goal of what e-commerce is, you want somebody to find what they're looking for and click into it and buy it, right? I feel like infinite scroll almost like encourages not making a decision about anything, just wasting your time, just scrolling forever through results. I don't think it makes sense at all for e-commerce. The only time that I think it makes sense to start to go into this direction, and it's when it makes sense, when it's like a mandated the client must have this feature and there's no negotiation at all, is about view all. So when Magento disables view all by default, it's not enabled. And the default settings for the number of results per category page are pretty low. I think they're like 12,
right?
32, 12, 24, and 32 or something like that. And some clients want me, they're like, view all must be disabled, must be enabled. And I have 200 products in this category and I need them all to show up. Then I'm not sure that I think that should need to be a requirement, but you start to run into some performance issues on the back end with Magento with generating those types of category pages. So you might want to start to look into that direction. I think at 200, there is an end in sight, but view all for my entire catalog of, 50,000 products probably doesn't make much sense to me ever.
I would like to throw one last thing out there, which is, if you're watching this video now, this is the opinion in 2018. Okay. Like, or at the beginning of 2018, where we're heading, I think is going to break a lot of what we just talked about. And progressive web apps, in particular, I saw a talk from the director of technology from JH, as they would pronounce it, JH, which is a Magento agency in Nottingham in the UK. And they were talking about how they created an iOS app with React Native that was a headless Magento. And so it was fed entirely from API, and how they were basically going to they're going to bridge what they know from the React Native space into PWAs. And they made a really great point in that the iOS mandate for developing, like the iOS experience for mobile apps, has specific connotation or like specific design guidelines that you expect to have in every app. And having a really fast, thumbable scrolling list of products is one of them. What tends to happen is, especially in like, their use case was a parts supply company that was a B2B company that was selling, bits and bobbles from, like a tool manufacturer. And their use case was, there are thousands and thousands and thousands of products in the category, and it needs to be insanely fast, and they need to be able to thumb through it and find exactly what they're looking for. And so it was a part of the design guideline. I do think that as we move more toward mobile first, and as we get more app-like, some of these requirements begin to drop off, because the way that we're even doing product marketing, which was some of the caveats I drew, might even fade away, because the experience that we can even deep link into apps now is something that we're not taking enough advantage of. So if you do have a native app, you can deep link to products in native apps today. And maybe those are things that we need to get closer to, but as the way the web stands today, the way that most people expect the web to work in early 2018, I think all of our advice is really sound.
What about when someone, like, we're talking about specific browsing experience, but what about discovery experiences? I think, there's going to be, I know of a lot of sites out there that do have discovery sections of their site, whether it's a combination of content and products, or products that are connected to contents. How do you see Infinite Scroll playing into those experiences?
I think a lot of the same points go. I do want to just comment on Philip really quick, and then we'll circle back. I do want to say, just talking about the iOS experience, the Apple, iPhone experience, a lot of those experiences have the problems we've described that a lot of Magento implementations in Infinite Scroll, everyone I've ever seen, has solved, right? So, an iOS app typically has a sticky footer. An iOS app or an iOS web app typically has, back solved for lists, or you're very annoyed with it. I'm sure you've seen an app, at least some at some point, where you click back and it doesn't go to the right place, and you're like, this app is janky, this is ridiculous, this is a joke, right? People have this filter where they're so used to the web, people who have been involved, developers, whatever, in the web for a while, they feel like that's somehow not janky. They don't have the same reaction to a website doing it, whereas they'll have that reaction when an app does it. So the barrier, the boundary for some developers is in a different place. And so I think that's one of the reasons it's different. And I think that goes somewhat for content as well, because I think some of content has it more figured out, and it's also simpler. But that being said, I think Max's point about leaving the site is still very relevant. And so if you have a lot of content, you want people to get lost in that content, which is not necessarily a bad thing. It might be great to have an infinite scroll. Like I mentioned before, Pinterest has an infinite scroll. You might want that, right? You might want to just link to Pinterest. That's your content strategy. But that doesn't mean that your WordPress blog necessarily needs to have an infinite scroll. Maybe it should, maybe it shouldn't. I just go back to what I started with, A/B test.
That's a really great point. A/B testing is always a good way to go when it comes to things like this. Good. All right. Here's the next question. What's the most innovative feature that you've seen implemented on Magento in the past few months? Over to Philip.
I have to think about this one. There's a lot of really interesting things. I wouldn't say that what's the most innovative feature that you've seen implemented on Magento, so much as I think people are starting to do a lot more with content in commerce. I saw a product detail page some time ago that really intrigued me, in that the way that they called out details or features of their products was, you know, very, very editorial. And I actually called it narcissistic. It's like, our product is so important that you need to see every little tiny detail, and we need to tell you in 12,000 words or less exactly why you need to buy this product. I think it's overkill for most people or brands, but especially for products that most of the websites that I see today suffer for a lack of content. Not that they, it is having too much content is not a problem that most people face. Really, I think you need to, you would do well to invest more in creating more engaging content about your products. Because customers want to feel like they understand your product, and they feel like they want to know what they're going to get out of your product. So giving them opportunity to sort of pore over or labor over the details of what makes your product special or what makes your brand special is something I think that a certain type of buyer would really appreciate. But as far as a feature, I think user-generated content is something that we're not doing enough of. A lot of companies are just opting to slap up Instagram feeds on their product detail pages or something so they can get some customers' pictures up on their website. I think it needs to go a little further than that. And there's a lot of companies like Turn2 and some others, Yotpo, I think, that are doing some really interesting user-generated content allowing users to put their voice onto your website. There's a whole host of challenges and sort of operationally how you make that work as a business. And it, like anything else, if you put it up and then never curate it and you don't keep it going, it gets stale and it starts to give some age to your website. The point of UGC or user generated content is that it's constantly refreshing, right? So if you don't tend to it, it'll die. It'll actually hurt you if you don't make that an ongoing program that you're nurturing. So that's really kind of my advice. I'm sure there's cool plugins and stuff is probably what some people are looking for from me, but I couldn't give you one prescriptive thing. So.
Max, what about you?
Yeah, I tried to think about this question. I mean, I think that the biggest thing that's going on is the move to PWA. And I know that there's some efforts to kind of, you know, not the official Magento stuff, but there are some companies I know, like Deity.io, I think is how you pronounce it, published a demo, I think literally just yesterday, of what they rolled out. And I know there are other companies working on that. I think that's probably, in my mind, that's kind of the biggest innovation that we're seeing right now. Yeah, I think that would be my answer.
Nice. Todd?
I think that's great. I haven't seen, I mean, a lot of the innovative things I could talk about are more on the back end, so may not be super, super vivid. So I'm going to actually go back to a site that I worked on a while back that had a really an innovative feature, I thought, from a design perspective that I just, I thought was nice. I don't see it often, but I think it's just because it's hard, not because it's not great. And that was that they designed the category structure to really be a journey. So, you know, you visited the homepage and you kind of saw one perspective and the background of the site and everything kind of looked a certain way. And then as you dug through, as you went into the category page or different sections into the site, the entire background changed to make it feel like you were farther in, deeper into the site. It was really interesting, and I thought that was actually very innovative. I'd like to see more of that, but I know that's not exactly answering the question. Sorry.
Oh, no, that's really cool. I love that.
I mean, I get the sense that what people are wanting us to say, or what the asker is wanting us to say, is like, you should, you know, have voice enabled. Like, you should be able to, you know, buy stuff with your Google Home, which, you know, I think it comes down to, it really depends on what your strategy is and what are the types of products you're selling and who your audience is. You know, in for the most part, you know, most people have so much work to do on just getting their Magento site right that all the other stuff, like all these, you know, super fancy future leaning commerce experiences, like, don't neglect the thing you already have that's working. Just put a little more effort into that, and it'll pay off in spades. People want new. People want new stuff, and it's never exciting when someone says, "Oh yeah, but you know, you're not doing this very well yet. You should probably do that first."
Yeah, I think what you're getting at, Philip, is make sure you're doing the things that you know are super available, low hanging fruit. Like, make sure you're getting low hanging fruit done. Don't miss those opportunities. Like, UGC is something that's been around for a long time, and there are still a lot of brands that don't do it well. So make sure that you're doing that well. good stuff. All right, here's another question. Do you have any recommendations to prep for the M2 Dev certification? Todd, I'm going to send this one your way.
Sure. So, I mean, I think the most obvious one is to actually take the Magento U training, right? You know, Magento provides this training, so it kind of makes sense that some degree of the test is going to reflect on content that's in the training. I'd also recommend looking at the developer documentation, right? Make sure you're looking at the latest 2.2 documentation and just, you know, go through it, get familiar with the different concepts. And then another thing I'd really strongly suggest is take some problem, even if it's already solved, ideally if it's not solved yet, but some problem and build a module for it, right? It can be in your free time. You don't have to worry about deadlines or anything like that, but put together a module that solves a problem. It can be a small problem, a big problem, whatever type of problem. I recommend not aiming too high. You know, you aim for the moon, you might not get there, but you know, try to build something that touches the front end, that touches the admin, maybe it touches the system configuration, it touches the, you know, the crons, right, the events, the DI components of Magento. Try to experience all of those things so that you have some familiarity, and not just from, you know, reading about them or doing a little, you know, digging in a certain area, debugging an issue or something like that, but really from having to build something that uses these things, because that'll help you really understand it. And then if you really want to go farther than that, go teach someone else how to use those things. Go tell someone, go after you've done that, go to someone else and explain it to them, right? And even if it's, you know, they call this rubber duck programming, that you explain your problems to a rubber duck sitting on your desk, and it helps you figure it out and solve it because you think it through when you have to explain it. But you know, whenever you can teach or explain something, that's when you really learn it. So if you have the opportunity to do that, if you're working somewhere and maybe in a Magento agency with other junior developers, and you can relay what you've learned to them, you know, take advantage of that. That's what.
Yeah, and just to add on that, I mean, I'm a very active blogger. You can go to my website, maxchadwick.xyz. I'm going to plug that there.
Hey, that's some self-promo. Nice. I like that.
the point of what I'm trying to say is just to build on Todd. I mean, yeah, teaching other people, that's one of the main reasons that I blog. And I'm not, so you don't need to even physically be with somebody to teach them things. And it doesn't need to be one-on-one. You can write about it and you can create your own blog. And you can publish it there, and then all of a sudden you've benefited yourself by learning it better through writing about it, but you've also helped other people by publishing it and making that knowledge available and searchable on the web. So that, for me personally, blogging has been, it's helped me a lot to learn about Magento.
And my, nice. my bit of advice, as someone who has all 5 Magento certifications at the moment, the first thing is certification prep. The best kind of certification prep is the hands-on real world experience. There's nothing that will replace just having real use cases and real problems to solve, like Todd said. But the Magento 2 dev certification doesn't exist yet, which is, I think, something that needs a little clarity in this question, which is, you can begin prepping now, but Magento does 2 things. They usually put out a study guide when they announce the date of a test that's going either into beta or into public availability. So there will be a study guide. And then Magento also, through Magento U, usually aggregates the kind of content that you need that hits on the topics of the study guide. Now, Magento U has at times been sort of panned as either not being relevant in the content. Like, for instance, a lot changed from Magento 2 to 2.1 to 2.2. And so the content sort of lags behind a bit, behind the platform. Another thing people have complained about in the past is that the certifications are, like, they ask questions that have absolutely no real world use case. A good example would be, you know, explicit class names of like, in the enterprise module of the reward points. Like, it's just, there's no reason to ask that question. It doesn't have any value. It's something that's easily referenced. So those are the kinds of things I don't think you can prepare yourself for anyway. Hopefully, you know, one of my hopes is that something digital can help inform the creation of the Magento 2 certification test. And that's something that, you know, we're hoping to be able to speak into. And I think the broader community will be able to speak into it as well. But my advice would be, don't wait until the study guide comes out. Get your hands dirty now. Todd and Max are both 100% right. But when the study guide comes out, go through the study guide and find where your gaps are. Find where are the areas that you have. Highlight the areas that you have the most knowledge in, and find the areas that you have no knowledge in. And those are the areas to invest in. Those are the areas that you're going to get hurt the most on. And if, you know, we'll know more about it when it's announced. I think there's 3 certifications that are coming out before the end of 2018. And you know, usually there's a bunch of Magento agencies that put out great study guide supplements. So Swift Daughter, if you're taking the Magento 2 solution specialist exam, which does exist today, you could go take it now. Swift Daughter has a great annotated study guide that helps you learn a lot more. It's like 100 pages long. It's ridiculous. It's a great place to start. But as we get closer to the actual test date landing, there should be community resources to help you as well. So that's kind of my 2 cents. Oh, you're muted, Brian.
Good. Thank you.
I see
Thank
how
you guys.
It is. You're like watching YouTube videos while I'm talking.
Of course.
Sounds about right.
I mean, it's YouTube.
I've been getting
crap. I like it. It has infinite scroll.
Well, thank you guys again. We've run out of time today. I hope our viewers got a lot out of it, out of this session. I certainly did. We'll be back again in 2 weeks on Thursday, 12 p.m. Pacific. And what is this? 3 p.m. Eastern. 2 weeks from today. We will see you there.
Thanks.
Bye.
Thanks, everyone.